आई थिंक योर माइक इज म्यूट सर.
इनकॉम्पेटेबल टाइप इन असाइनमेंट ऑफ कैर पॉइंटर टू कैर. ओके Syncat it will return.
Sir, the size of array will be doubled, na? str3.
Oh, right. But there should not be a problem because the 20 size will be enough, right? It means it will actually, that size problem will be given at runtime, not at compile time. Here it will give a compile time problem. So there must be some problem during this assignment. Okay. There must be some problem during this assignment.
Sir, str2 aage likhun, tarpor str1 ta likhun.
str2. Achha, ami eta bhul korlam. Ami thik korlam to kichukhon aage chilo.
Sir, you can take as integer and then you can take the length of str alien of str1.
Yeah, because it takes the size, no? It's 40.
Okay. We will
define this size.
Okay. We will check it later. Okay. We'll check it later.
Okay.
It is actually working, not an issue. We'll check it later why it is not working in third variable. Okay. Some assignment problem should be there, I think so. Okay. So this is the vowel, the number of vowels and number of consonant count in a string. So you have to give a string and your program will give an output at how many vowels, A, E, I, O, U. It may be a capital A, E, I, O, U, or it may be a small letter A, E, I, O, U. So how many vowels are repeated in your given input string and how many consonants are there, how many digits are there, and how many blank spaces are there if you are using any kind of blank spaces. So in the first case, I will have to assign all these local variable as zero. Okay, I have declared all these four variables and assigned all the local variable as zero. Okay, instead of that, if they are not taking any kind of, it's actually working like a counter. So that's why I have initialized all the variable as a zero, because counter always start from zero and then it will add 1, 1, 1, 1. If you don't give zero or assign zero here, initialize zero here, then it may take a garbage value and that addition, that increment operation will be pop up on the garbage value. So that's why we have to assign it or initialize it as zero, because all these four are working like a counter there. Vowels, consonant, digit, and space, all these four variables. Now we have taken the string as input. So our string name is line here, okay, as input. Now we will run a for loop, okay. In this for loop, this for loop will run from zero. And I think you can understand this thing. I have already discussed this thing in my last class. That means the loop will, repeatedly running until it will reach the null character or the end of the string. Okay. And then we will perform the plus plus I, that means your increment operation. Now within if condition checking, we will check all these conditions. I think it is clear to you. So this is actually or, logical or. I think you have remembered it. This two vertical bar is nothing but logical or. So line of I equal to small a, that should be within single quote. Okay, then line of I equal to small e, then logical or line of I equal to I. So I have checked for all five small vowels as well as five capital vowels. Okay, all kind of letters I have checked, right? And if any one of these condition holds true during this line, okay, what you have given as the input through the terminal, then the vowels count out will be incremented by one or counting by one. If any one of these falls, or sorry, if all of these falls, okay, then it will go to this else if conditions. In the else if conditions, I actually given this logic that if small a to small z or capital A to capital capital Z, if any one of these conditions within the range is fallen, then these are consonants. Okay. And else if, within else if, here we will check the number or digits, that whether our input string holds any digits or not that falls in between this range of 0 to 9. Okay. So all digits should be falling within this range of 0 to 9. So digit counter will be incremented. And in the last case, if our line, the string has any kind of blank spaces or not, so that's why I've used two single quote by giving one blank space here. Okay. Two blank space is working here like a character. Please remember, I have already told in the last class. Okay. The blank space in string or in character array is working like a character. It will also hold 1 byte memory space, just like the other characters. Okay. So plus plus space. The space counter will be incremented by one. And at the end, I have printed all the four variables with its final values. Right. Let's run this code. So enter a string. Suppose I am a good boy. Right. Instead of entering the string, I'm entering a full line. Okay, that's why I've used line as a name of the variable, right? So how many vowels are there? 6. Let's count it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I is also a vowel. 6 vowels. Consonants. So apart from vowels, all the others are consonants. Total 5 consonants, including the white spaces. How many white spaces are there? Total 4 white spaces. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. You cannot consider this one as white space and this one as white space, because it is started from here, and here it will get a \0 by default. Okay. So your white space counting will stop here, right? And there is no digits, so digits has not been counted. Is it clear? Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Let me run a code. Yes, sir. Let me run this code with a digits. Okay. Good boy. 97. The roll number. So here the digits has been counted too. Clear? Is it clear to everyone? Is this logic? This program is very important. Jaja program goes dagarchi. All the programs are very, very important. I have almost covered all the important programs in my lecture. Okay. All of you have to do all these programs.
Special character used for auto.
Special character ke tumake else part dhuki dite hobe. Special character e kono condition checking hoy na. You will have to give that one into else part. Here I am checking character wise. Arekta checking tomader bolechhilam je tumi ascii character di check korte paro. But ascii value di jodi check koro, you are not using any kind of string logic or character logic here. So it is not a string program. It will be some other kind of program. Some numerical programs, okay, but you can, if you want to check according to the string logic or character array logic, then you have to do this code. Okay, it's very simple. This code is very simple, right? But important as well. So this is all about string. Okay, there is nothing more to discuss about string. So in tomorrow's lab, I am going to give assignments on string. You have to complete, there will be 6, 7, or 8 programs, I think so. You have to complete all the programs. And among these 6 or 8 programs, I think I have covered almost all the programs in my theory class, okay, of the string. Okay, so today I just want to give you a very basic funda or basic idea about the function. Okay, what is the function? I already gave that basic idea while I discussed about the modular programming approach. Why C is a modular programming approach. I have told that the entire C program is divided in number of modules or functions. Okay. And each and every function has their own job or own responsibility. Right. So if you remember that one, so that is the starting point of a function. That is the starting point of a function. So what is function? Function is nothing but a block of codes, a block of statements that perform a particular task or a specific task. So what is function? As per the definition, a function is a block of code or a block of programming statements that is used to perform a specific task or a particular task. And these functions will play a very, very major role in to make a programming language as a modular programming language. Okay, so our entire program will be divided into number of modules, and each module is called a function, okay, or a method. Function is sometimes called as method. Okay, so these terms are simultaneously used, either function or method or procedure or modules. Okay, so you have to remember all these terms, right? So it has been already written here, enables modular programming, right, which I have already told. Some of the functions we have already learned or already used in our program multiple number of times, like main function, which is the main driver function. Ami ekta tomader example diyechhilam, if you remember this example, I don't know how many of you have remembered that example, that suppose a real life example I have given. Suppose you are organizing a birthday party at your home and you are the main organizer of that party. So you are working like a main function, and you have given responsibility to each one of your friends who are invited as a host of that birthday party. So one friend, you have given responsibility to arrange the birthday cake to one friend. You have given a responsibility to arrange the catering to another friend. You have given the responsibility to arrange the decoration of the birthday party to another friend. So all these three friends has been given three different or specific tasks or particular tasks to perform in the birthday party. And after performing that task, they will report to you, because this is your birthday and you are the main organizer of that birthday party. Do you remember this example? I have already given that example. Have you remembered
it? Sir.
So that example is similar, a skeleton representation of a function. So you are the main function, you are the main driver function. So all other sub functions, your friends are your sub functions, and all these friends has to be reported to you about their activity or their task. So in your C program, it's doing in a similar way. Okay, you can define multiple sub functions in your C program, and all this sub function has to report to the int main or void main function about the task. Okay, about the task, that what task you are going to perform, right? About that task, what task you are going to perform, that you will have, that your sub function has to be reported into the to the main function. So one thing you should remember, that your program, C program, must have only one main function, one and only one main function. It cannot have more than one main function, because there is only one driver function. But your C program may have multiple sub functions. অনেকগুলো বন্ধু তোমার থাকতে পারে, এবং প্রত্যেকটা বন্ধুকে there may be different type of works, different type of tasks you can give to your different kinds of friends. So each friend is one sub function. So your program may have more than one or multiple sub functions. Okay, now how we can define a function? Once a function execution is completed, control return to the place where the function was called. Same function can be accessed from the different places within a program, has a predefined prototype. So you are the main function. So in the C program, all the other sub function can be called within the main function. Ki bollam? In the C program, all the other sub function can be called within the main function. So main function is the actual starting source of your program. You have to remember it. Your main function is the actual starting source, which will start the party. So you are the main organizer, because this is your birthday. So you are announcing, okay, today is my birthday, and I am announcing that today we have to throw a birthday party. So you are the organizer, you are the main organizer, and you are the starter of your birthday party. So according to your command or your suggestion, your friends or sub functions are working. So that's why all the sub function has to report to the main function, and main function is actually the starting or working like a starter of your C program or calling the functions. Okay, so advantages of using functions: it supports modular programming, the length of the source code can be reduced. Okay, with the help of function, the length of the source code can be reduced. Easy to locate and isolate faulty function. So that line I have also discussed during the modular programming approach. If you remember, there is a testing team. I told that there is a testing team. Whenever you have developed any software in any company, there must be present one testing team who will test all type of possibilities or all type of criteria on that developed software, right? If any kind of fault has been found in any portion of the software, the testing team will inform the manager of the developer team. Then the developer team will pick up the problem and the team who actually deal with that problem. Okay, so that team is actually responsible to do that specific function. That's why the manager, it's a very easy job for the manager to pick up the fault team, the default team who actually gives a faulty function. Okay, so suppose if you are not using function in your program and your program contains suppose 1000 lines of code. Acha, 2 minute, ek to important phone is okay, just 2 minute, okay. Okay, hello, all of you are there? Hello, all of you are present?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it is easy to locate and isolate the faulty functions if your entire program is divided in a number of small modules or small functions, right? So it is easy job for the manager to, among all the employees or among all the teams, which team has done this faulty function or has done the code which is not correctly working. That complaint has been sent by the tester team. So he or she can identify that particular problem and can warn that team that they can change the function accordingly. Okay, but instead of that, if that person does not use any kind of functions in their program, so in company, the software programs are generally built of million trillions of lines. This is not a 50 lines or 100 lines programs. Okay, there should be more than million trillions of lines of programs are there. So obviously, if you are not using any functions to divide the program into number of modules or number of sub functions, then if any fault occurs, then it will be very difficult for the manager to identify where the fault occurs and which team is responsible to do the job of that particular portion. It's very difficult. Okay, so that is the job or advantage or benefits of a function that you are going to use in your program, okay, for testing purpose, okay. Second one is function can be used by other programs. So the last advantage is that the function can work as a reusability, code reusability is very important concept. Okay, in object-oriented programming, you are going to learn this concept of code reusability. That means the same code can be used by the other program. So suppose you have defined one function, and that function can be used some other program. Okay, it may be possible that two projects are simultaneously running in your company. So one project is developing one function, and suppose and the second project has come after a few months of the first project running. Okay, so the second project will require the similar kind of functions. So obviously the manager is very intellectual enough to provide the functions which has been already developed in the first project. It will simply provide that code to the second project. So that amount of that particular lines of code doesn't need to be write again, okay, by the help of the developer team. Okay, so that's why it is called a reusability of the functions by some other programs. Okay, these are the advantages of using our functions or modules in a program. So functions are generally two types. Okay, one is built-in function or system-defined function, okay, or library functions, which you have already used multiple times, stdio.h, that math.h, string.h, these are the functions, stdlib.h, these are the functions we have already used, okay, as a system defined function, right? So this function is nothing to be discussed because this function is system defined. So all the function has been stored into these header files, which has been stored to you. These are the system defined functions, okay? And you cannot change the definitions or the job responsibility of these functions, okay? Suppose, as for example, in your birthday party, suppose there will be one cook whose job is to cook something, okay? So you cannot ask him to do some other job, okay? Because his job is predefined at your house. He is only for the cooking, okay? He will not do any other job. So that is a system defined or built-in function, okay? And the second thing that we are going to learn in this chapter, that is user defined functions, how we can define a function by our own, okay? That means we have to define the function which is written by the user itself at the time of programming. Okay, that is a user defined function. And in this chapter, our main objective is to learn how to define a user defined function, how to write a user defined function, okay? So a function has been divided into these four types: function prototype, function call, function arguments and parameters, function definition. Okay, so a function has been defined into these four types. Okay, and that means the overall structure of a function has been formed into these four types. When you are writing a function program, you have to remember or you have to understand these four different subsection of a function has to be defined. Okay, so these are the elements of user-defined functions. That a user-defined function should contain all these four elements. First element is the function prototype. Second element is the function call. Third element is the function arguments and parameters. And the fourth element is the function definition. Okay. So in the next class, I'm going to define about these four types and I will show what are the various classification of the user-defined function. Again, the user-defined function is further classified based on these types. Okay, based on these types. So these are the four substructure that each and every user-defined function should contain or must contain these four sub-elements within it. Clear? Up to this, anyone has any questions regarding function? Is it clear to everyone? Whatever we have discussed regarding function up to this? Hello, is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, fine.
So sir, I have a question.
Bolo.
Sir, how can we know, sir, which string or which word is longer than another? How did we know that? Because if we compare them, then we get the output that this string or this word is longer than this. But how did it work?
Means you can count the length of the two string and you can easily compare in between the length. Length is actually your integer, no? Length is not a character. That string length,
yes,
whatever,
yes,
whatever value the string length will return as an integer.
Mm-hmm.
So you can compare the two length very easily.
এখন কোশ্চেন ওটা না স্যার বলছি মানে দুটো স্ট্রিং যখন কম্পেয়ার করি এবার একটা তো ভ্যালু বলে যে এই স্ট্রিংটা বড় সেটা কোন দিকটা থেকে বলে অ্যাসকি ভ্যালু নাকি।